Okay. Hello, everyone. we'll start the video at the beginning to give some time to others to enter the webinar as well. So enjoy. See you soon.
Imagine you're getting ready for the vacation you've been planning and looking forward to all year. Everything is packed and ready. Regardless of where you are headed, your company is up and running. It's good to know that even if the contract of a lifetime is signed, your colleagues will be up to the challenge. And you? You don't have to change your plans. Everything you need is right there, at your fingertips. Webcon BPS is a platform that manages all of the business processes, making sure everything works like clockwork. It coordinates people and goals in every department and every level of the company. It helps your team take full advantage of complex IT systems and collected data. Your colleagues can focus on what's important. Webcon BPS streamlines business processes, automates routine activities, and eliminates bottlenecks. So just enjoy your vacation. You're the master of your own time. Instead of calls and emails, simply check the progress whenever you feel like it. You can finally focus on what's most important. Webcon BPS helps thousands of employees all over the world. They get the tasks, documents, and data to help them achieve their goals. With a business process management platform like this, everyone works at the peak of their efficiency, making impossible things happen. Because everything is a process and everyone is involved. Nothing beats a well-earned vacation when you're confident about things getting done. Try Webcon BPS today on top of your SharePoint environment on-premises or in the cloud. Are you ready to optimize your business processes? Webcon BPS, the ultimate business management platform.
Okay, good, thank you. So let's start the webinar. First of all, can you hear me? Hello everyone. My name is Bianca, and I'm the digital marketing manager at Ecommerce and your host today. I'm so happy to see you in such a significant number, and I'm happy that you can participate in our webinar entitled Why RPA is Not Enough. This webinar it will be a complex one, and we'll approach insightful subjects related to the digital business transformation. If you have any questions during the webinar, feel free to write it in the question and answer section. So I hope that you can hear me well. If anyone has any problems, please notice us, and we will try to find a solution. I hope that you enjoyed the video from the beginning. It is an advert for Webcon, our partner, and it reveals a very nice way in which digitalization improves people's life. So let's go through the agenda and see the main chapter that we will discuss today. So we'll start the webinar by presenting the land of BPM and RPA confusion, and we'll continue with the differences between the two and what are the advantages and cautions for each. After this, my colleague Razvan will show you how BPM and RPA can work together using real cases from Ecommerce clients. At the end, we will finish by underlining the most important key takeaways and the most appropriate mix of technology for the right digital transformation approach. So let's start the webinar. Before we discuss about a digital transformation project, it is very important to understand the differences between RPA and BPM and how they work together. So in order to do this, we need to have the answers for the following questions. What are the differences between RPA and BPM? How are they similar? Do they have the same end goal? How does RPA play a part in a larger automation improvement strategy? It is an alternative for BPM. It is RPA an alternative for BPM or an addition in the business automation approach? Sorry for my emotions. So now I will introduce Michael, our special guest from Webcon, that will talk more about the land of RPA and BPM confusion.
So, hello everyone. I hope you can hear me. You can? You can, all right.
Yes, we can.
Awesome, sorry. That was confusion on my side, but I'm very happy to be here as a guest host of this webinar. Let me tell you what is my personal motivation to do this. And this actually comes from a potential client. We started the conversation. He was interested in what is Webcon doing. He basically told me, guys, I implemented RPA. So why would I need you? where is the need? Where does it come from? Because I cannot see it. It's not transparent to me. If I even should invest my time in investigating, because technically RPA is for processes and BPM is also for processes. So my initial reaction was like, hey, but these two systems, these two categories are doing quite different things. And actually it's not so easy to compare them on similar cases using similar use cases. So that was the whole idea. And I talked with my friends and then Corsa and said, guys and gals, you guys are experts in both. So why don't we do a webinar and basically bring some transparency into everything on the subject. And so me, and full disclaimer, I'm representing Webcon. So I'm representing the vendor side. Let me tell you how I see where this confusion comes from and why I believe this is important. So why is it important? First of all, whenever you invest in any technology, you want to spend your money wisely. That's the most obvious thing. But if the lines are not clear, if the definitions are not clear, if you don't know how to use the solution you've invested in up to its full potential, or if you are using it against its core purpose, then you might not spend your money wisely. Second of all, many clients fall into a trap that could be summarized by saying, if you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And sometimes people invest in technology and try to use it for everything. And in the long run, this also is not that great of an idea. The most vivid example relates to ERP systems, which we'll not be talking about that much today, but basically there are many companies that invested into ERP. This is the strictly core system for both organizations, but they built also many applications on top of it, turning it into like a giant monolith of a system with spaghetti of applications on top of it. And that made it heavy, that made it hard for maintenance, for upgrades, for further development. And also you don't want that to happen to you. And last but not least, I assume if you're on this webinar, you also want to be ahead of your competition. You want to know where to apply certain technologies, how to combine them, where not to use them as well. So that's why this webinar will be important to you. And how I see the confusion arising from RPA, BPM, and many, many more, is that whenever we put RPA on one side of the fence, it's robotic process automation, and then we put business process management, there is a process inside of the acronym itself. So that alone is already confusing. And on top of that, under BPM category, BPM as such is a discipline, but let's say we'll use it as a general term, as an umbrella term for multiple different other acronyms. And today we'll be focusing purely on software. And basically under that category, we have many, many more other acronyms and variations. So I've been in this business for 10 years and I've seen an evolution of terms significantly increasing. So BPM turned into BPMS to indicate it's about the software. Then it turned into IBPMS. So we are underlining intelligent factor of a given system. Most recently, we also talk about digital process automation. We also talk about low-code BPM. So we are inserting a way of delivery into what we are delivering. We also talk about process automation software. And if that was not enough, we also talk about workflow in general. Workflow as a term has been existing for many, many years. And actually, vast majority, if not all of the systems that fall into the categories I've mentioned before, they also have a workflow component in it. So and I don't even want to start on other variations and acronyms, because we can easily think about any variations related to hosting. You have software as a service, you have platform as a service, process as a service. So to be honest, I am in this space and I am getting confused with the amount of acronyms. And this is just about BPM, RPA, low code, and all of that. And I don't even want to think how many other acronyms are there outside of my small bubble. So if I were to categorize those two types of systems, I would say RPA is for the things that robots could do instead of humans. And BPM focuses on overall process, business process efficiency. So my colleagues from Encorsa will be talking about more like what are the details and their definitions and their take, because they do it on daily basis. This is just my pure first impression and categorization that I see. And if the amount of acronyms wasn't enough, also vendors don't make it easier. I'm one of them, so we might be slightly guilty to the things that I'll say, but hey, you have my honest insight here. So let me say this. First of all, how I observe the market, and obviously we are looking what our competition is doing and so on. And the first thing I see related to marketing is that everyone uses the same jargon. So everyone talks about optimization of processes, digital transformation, digitization, and so on and so forth. So for a regular person that is not functioning in that bubble, this is already quite a mess of terms and phrases. The second thing is that marketing departments in many cases get very creative with solution descriptions. So sometimes it's not just about, let's say, technical description, it's more purely marketing focused way of describing things. And as you can see, sometimes it gets out of control. And there's a lot of creativity in it for sure, but also it makes it confusing for clients to decide whether we need it, whether we like it, and so on and so forth. And the last thing is that something that I hear from our clients is that they stumble upon something that we could describe as PowerPoint engineering, because if you are on the sales meeting, if you're on the discussion purely on the sales level, in the PowerPoint you can do everything. so you can promise everything, and sometimes some clients fall victim of those over promises of the sales department. It's not intentional in many cases. It's just enthusiasm and so on and so forth. But this actually happens. What we happily do and we are very confident with is proof of concepts, is live workshops. So besides having initial discussion about the requirements and so on, we'll also be happy to prove to our clients and partners that will deliver the value that they expect. So you might use it for speaking with other vendors as well. And ultimately, you have to be happy with the solution. So you have to be sure that this is going to work. And on the other side of that fence of vendors that muddy the waters, there's also product development. And it might sound a little bit surprising if you are not following closely like products develop over the years. But how I see it is that many vendors basically cross the boundaries of original functionalities of their software. And this is actually quite natural. Everybody wants to stay on top of the trends and fall into as many categories as possible. So that in our context, that will mean that RPA vendors would add workflow components, for example, and they'll try to tap into, let's say, the BPM or the process management side of doing things. And the same goes for the other side. So the BPM vendors will add RPA functionalities into their systems. And again, that makes it complicated to evaluate solutions properly. What is sadly an outcome for some clients is that if they buy into the certain functionalities that are not in the core of a specific vendor is doing, they might get abandoned. So for example, some years ago, social BPM was a huge thing and it was promoted by many analysts and so on and so forth. But then basically it lost traction. It's not there anymore. And if somebody invested into that idea and so on, those people might get basically lost and abandoned. So they'll have to withdraw from it, whether they like it or not. So in those cases, I always recommend to our clients, hey, just ask your vendor what's the roadmap is. Most probably they'll not tell you what's the roadmap for the next 3 years because the market is so dynamic that it wouldn't make any sense. But for the next year, it's actually realistic. And by that, you will see what is the focus of a particular vendor, where are they headed with the product development, and what they focus on. And by that, you'll be able to judge whether the functionalities that you take, that you care about, are in the core or somewhere outside of it. So with that being said, my friend Katalin will talk about the details a little bit more, like how do we position RPA and BPM. And with that, Katalin, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you for the great presentation. It was awesome. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Now I will share my screen. I hope everything is seeing okay. I am Cătălin Profir, one of the founders of Encorsa. And Let's go deeper into details. Let's clarify things about digital transformation and its technologies, because now everybody is talking about digital transformation. It's not a trend anymore, it is a must. But from where should we begin? There are a lot of solutions, and somehow all of us and you are confused, and I intend to put some clarity in this topic. So let's begin with RPA. What is RPA? Everybody is talking about RPA. It comes from robotic process automation, and it is a technology that intend to solve a problem. It's intending to automate repetitive tasks, high volume tasks that are based on very clear rules, and with this approach is trying to take the burden from the humans to not do this boring work anymore. How is doing that? Very simple. Software robots is clicking in graphical interfaces of some other applications. So it's very easy to understand the distinction what is an RPA robot, because an RPA robot is working with the interface, so we can see it. He's not working behind the applications, somewhere behind the scenes with the database, but mainly it works with the interface following this click path, let's say, and can do a lot of activities like extracting data from some other applications, transferring to some other applications from email, from Excel files, can input data in many applications in the same time, even if it is required, and can reconcile data between different applications when we have no other options. So why should we use RPA? As I said, we should use RPA in order to free humans to do this boring activities, to reduce errors, because when you are doing the same lot of things all the day, you are prone to errors. So RPA is intending to and is succeeding to reduce error, and of course to increase the speed and compliance in activities. Another important reason for using RPA is when you want to integrate a current application that you have in your organization that can be integrated with API, with communication machine to machine, and you are putting the robot just to click in that application to transfer the data. So it's a very, very easy way to integrate your current stack of applications. Okay, let's talk a little bit about some RPA use cases to be more specific. RPA begins from the need to be used in call centers, for example, where people are under pressure and should do a lot of things very quick. And an RPA robot can collect customer data in real time and to offer to the human person everything aligned in the screen, or to update customer profiles in various systems without human interventions. The humans only will put some data in a place, and robots will propagate them in all the systems, because you have the next phone call, you have the next ticket, and you don't have time to manage these repetitive and high volume tasks. Another big category is, of course, using RPA in back office administration environments. What does this mean? It means that we can cover a lot of processes from finance, from HR, from marketing and sales, from support departments. But it's important to understand that RPA usually works for a single department or for automating tasks for individuals. So in finance, for example, a robot can open bank accounts, can collect pricing updates from different websites and to put them in the ERP. In HR, can collect and process CVs, filling documents. In marketing, automation and sales, we know already that some robots can send messages for us and doing those activities that that are very repetitive. In support departments, a robot can check for data accuracy, can consolidate reports, or can be used for IT procedures to open accounts, to update some fields if it is needed. So I think we should understand that many organizations are facing aging their IT systems, so they need a solution for working with those systems that can be integrated through API. RPA, it is a very, very good solution, a quick start for addressing this need. Talking about RPA advantages, as I said, it is a quick start. You will feel results immediately because can focus on your individual task, so can behave like a digital assistant for you, and can automate those repetitive tasks from your department. So imagine a new employee that is not familiar with the stack of applications. So if he will benefit of a digital assistant, he can just press a button and the robot will start doing things based on some inputs that are well established previously. And the human can take the coffee in silence, can talk, can think about some decisions. So it will be, will have a benefit from being helped by a digital assistant immediately, and he can be onboarded faster in the organization. Of course, as I said, with an RPA robot, the activities, those repetitive tasks will be done better, it will be done without errors, because the robot is not getting bored, he won't take a vacation, he won't ask for rising the salary, he will be very, very friendly. So it's a good solution for this type of activities. And yes, we should help human to do things, to do activities with added value. And like this, we'll have more happier employees with less frustration, because everything that can be automated, it is automated based on well-done RPA processes implemented. And the last point that I was underlying here is that, yes, it is indeed the need. If you have an application that can be integrated in a different way with API, with machine-to-machine communication, it is a cost-efficient way of integrating that application. So you can put a robot just to fill the data in the visual interface of that application. Of course, as any technology, it has some limits. So let's talk a little bit about some cautions that you should be aware of. Because an RPA robot is working with an interface of another application of a website, for example, it is dependent of that interface. And if that interface will change, the robot can be stopped, will be blocked in the activity. So this technology can be fragile and can need a lot of support, and we need to choose very wisely which applications we want to put in conjunction with RPA, because if those interfaces are changing, RPA is at risk. And when we need technical support, when we need humans to correct those problems, what we will gain through automation, we might lose. So it's very important to think and to plan in long term, because maybe we'll solve problems in short term, but if we are not taking into consideration that what we are automating can be changed, robots can be stuck, and we need more and more technical support, and we'll lose those advantages. How can we integrate the human decision making in this process? An RPA robot and this technology is not very comfortable with human decisions involved in the process, because he's executing the rule-based actions that he was set up for. And when we want human input, is very difficult. Of course, if we just want to prompt something to a human and to have his limit input, we can do it. But if we have a multi-step process, RPA is not the most appropriate technology for involving humans in the process. And I think the most important caution for CIOs, they should be aware that making them comfortable because they put some robots in solving some problems in the short term can be locked into maintaining those old systems, those legacy systems, because you are not supposed to change them anymore, because you'll keep them as they are. You put a robot above them, but in long term, it is a risk to keep the environment as it is. And maybe you'll face some bigger problems in 1 year, in 2 years, or whatever. So it's very important to be aware of this. Okay, so I would underline again that RPA is a solution for looking backward in the past. We are trying to solve the problems that we've created with our applications in the past, and we want to solve it immediately, but it's not necessarily a solution for transforming things for the future. Okay, let's go to BPM, because the time is going very, very rough. BPM comes from business process management, as you already heard from Michael, and it is a class of platforms for digitalizing business processes end-to-end for the entire organization. So unlike RPA that is designed usually for a single department, this type of automation solutions are designed for a holistic approach when you want to digitalize all your processes from your organization and you want to have an overview of all of your activities. How is it doing that? With the BPM platform, you can create new digital workflows if you are at the beginning in the digital transformation process, or you can optimize your existing processes that you are.
I think we've
lost Cătălin. I hope you can hear me. Bianca, do you hear me or?
I can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. So I think we've Cătălin has some technical problems. So I will try and pick up the presentation from where he left it. Just 1 second. Cătălin, are you back?
Yes, I don't know what happened. Everything were looking fine on my side, but Zoom was restarting. So
okay,
I'll be back.
Yeah, please share your screen again. And
yes,
the beauty of live webinars happened.
Yeah. I don't know why that happened. Please confirm when you lost me.
At the second bullet of how, I believe.
Yes, you were starting to talk about the second bullet.
Okay. So, okay. I will talk a little bit faster because I think we are in rush. How is BPM working? As I said, can develop new digital workflows. If you have no digital workflows implemented, or you can optimize your existing processes. And then in this, you can integrate your existing application based on API communication, because this time BPM platforms are specialized in integrating some other applications based on API. Why should we do that? BPM is very useful when we want to develop processes between departments, so cross-department processes for the entire organization, and we want to standardize them, to monitor and control those processes in order to increase the compliance, to have better management. Okay, let's talk about some use cases. Virtually, you can build what type of processes you want and you need in your organization, and our priorities for this for the moment that your organization is. So we can talk about industry-specific processes like ISO procedures, quality management, corrective and preventing actions, claims and complaints, production workflows, so any type of processes specific for your industry. Of course, there are some common processes that we can encounter in all the organizations, in financial, for example, like invoice approval, business trip approval, or in HR, like onboarding, leave request, very common, or IT, like asset management, help desk processes, and so on. We can talk again, unlike sometime RPA, about mission critical processes, because having a digital workflow, you are transforming your organization, and you can have, instead of moving papers between departments, you can have a digital workflow for your core business. So we can talk about new products approval. In financial sector, we can talk about scoring engine, or in insurance about claims management, or in retail about opening new stores, any kind of important processes that should be very well designed for involving all the people in your organization. And imagine that any step will trigger the next step. So the process will go smoothly in your organization. Another category of processes are those around an ERP. So let's suppose you have already an ERP. This is the first stage of digitalization for many companies, but you want to keep your RPA as clean as possible. So if you want, your business are evolving and you want, you need some other processes and you don't want to upgrade your RPA, either because it's expensive or either because it's difficult to do that and you want to keep the RPA as clean as possible. So you are extending its functionalities by taking data from the RPA, putting them on a workflow, and at the end of the process, you can deliver the data back to the ERP system to be stored and to be parked there. So you can extend your RPA functionalities through a BPM, which will behave as a new layer in your organization. And another type of categories as those tailor-made application, you can approach them by custom code, but as you heard in some other webinars that we had, it's not the best approach because it's expensive, it take too much time, but based on a BPM, you can have custom solutions for your business that can be very easy to implement and to adopt and very easy to be modified when your business is modifying. So we can talk about, I don't know, product label, evaluation and approval, membership management, news production, whatever is the core business for you and is very special and you can't have it on a commercial off the shelf. You need a special product, but you can't afford to invest in a custom coded application. You want to have quick results and you need a flexible system that can address the changes in your organization. Okay, let's talk a little bit about BPM advantages. BPM is offering a high level overview of the company because when you are implementing such a solution, you are thinking about all the departments and, as I said, about data flow between departments in order to increase the collaboration in the organization. It's a better option for involving humans along the processes because with such a platform, you can build a new application, will behave like a new applications with forms, with steps, and you can involve people in the process to take the appropriate decision to fill in their input in the steps of the process. And like this, you can have at the end a single workspace for all the departments with this new layer, with all the processes that are integrating already existing applications. You will have a single workspace for all the departments. Everybody will use the BPM, will have the same type of interfaces, all the processes will be in the same place, and the BPM will talk through API with the other applications. So like that, you can have a unified IT infrastructure. And as I already said, you can go from supportive processes to core business ones. Once you can have an agile implementation, you can take the digitalization step by step because BPM can absorb all of your processes step by step. And if you are choosing a low-code BPM system, things are even better because you can modify the workflow very easily anytime, even by your own IT department, because the workflow can be visually designed and can be very easily modified anytime if the process is changing, and usually is changing. We know that nothing can stand more than I don't know, 6 months, 1 year, and now with this COVID pandemic, things are changing very fast. Okay, in order to be objective, we should talk also about BPM limits, because we are talking about a bunch of processes that should be implemented, especially when you don't have digital workflows implemented, you need to select the right candidates for digitalization, the right processes, and you need a good business analysis. So you won't be prone to jump immediately into automation like RPA just to solve some problems very quick, but it's good to have from the beginning a good vision about what you want to achieve. Here it is in fact an opportunity. Don't digitalize processes just like this. Use this opportunity to transform the process, because digital transformation is also about transforming your processes. So use this opportunity of thinking better your processes. Don't keep the processes as they are on paper and just make them digital. You have the opportunity of transforming those processes. And at the end, a small caution, there are a lot of solutions in the market. Many of them are in the cloud, because BPM is working with important data this time, and the data will be kept in the BPM, unlike RPA that is keeping the data on your side. It's very important to understand how that BPM is storing the data, if you'll be captive in the cloud, if that called vendor lock-in, because if at the end you want to migrate from that solution to another, it's very important to take your data. That's a very important asset, and you should secure it. Okay, now at the end, let's imagine a place where robots and humans can work together. We believe very, very much in this approach of putting in the same place humans and robots. We know that a BPM system is properly for involving humans in taking the right decisions. But let's suppose that in some steps of the processes, we want to transfer some data to some other applications that don't have an API. So BPM system can trigger RPA robot to handle this job, to execute those tasks and to report back in the BPM. So like that, you have all the entire process in the same place in the BPM, but at some steps you can have the robots executing some steps. And because we know that sometimes RPA can be blocked, we will have the BPM acting as a supervisor for the RPA robots. So we think that a better strategy for automations is to put these technologies together. And BPM will serve as a safety net for handling these exceptions. And if the process will stuck on the automation path, the task can be routed to the humans and the process can continue. Unlike if you have only an RPA process and everything will be stopped until technical support department will intervene. But more specific about this way of automating, of putting these technologies together, we will find out from my colleague Razvan, that will give us specific examples from what we encounter in our experience. Razvan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Cătălin. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes.
Before going further, I want to let you know that we've seen the Q&A questions that some of you have already submitted, and we're going to address those a little bit later after a few slides. And thank you for the questions. And now I'm gonna show and talk about two case studies, actual customers that we had and experience where we've used both RPA and BPM in order to create an environment in which humans and robots work together. I will start with the first study case, which is about ANOFM. ANOFM is a governmental agency that deals with the workforce in Romania. And during the COVID pandemic, the Romanian government needed help to process hundreds of thousands of applications and validate them, and also make payments for all of those. Down here, you can see part of the process we have created for them in the BPM platform we used, in this case, Webcon. And I'm going to explain the process in a bit more detail on a slide a bit later. For now, what you need to know is that to help ANOFM, we had to implement only in 10 days, which wasn't a lot for implementing a custom solution. We had to implement in 10 days a solution. So it was a no-brainer for us that low-code BPM is precisely what they would need. During the analysis phase, we've discovered that the process required integrations with two other platforms, which had no APIs available for integrations. This wasn't such a great news, because doing it in 10 days and also integrating to other systems, probably most of the vendors would think that this is impossible. Once we've heard that we need to integrate some platforms so fast, we have decided to use RPA, and especially RPA low code, in order to be able to stick to the deadline. Now I will show you the process step by step in a simplified manner, with some graphical interface. At first, Romanian companies had to submit applications with their employees to one of the governmental platforms. From there, an RPA robot, in this case, would take the new applications and submit them to the BPM. The BPM, in this case, is a Webcon, a web platform in which employees can work. In here, in the BPM, the governmental workers, about 200 of them, would take the files and start processing them step by step, validating them quickly and sending them from one department to another to finalize the work. Once the responsible employees that worked in this system gave the final approval, a robot would make the payment into a banking software. Now, I said that 200 users used this system. They had to also learn how to use the system very fast in those 10 days that we had deadline to implement the process. And apparently, with very good organization and very intuitive platforms already built and tested by our vendors, we've managed to train 200 people in less than 4 or 5 hours to use the platform. And also, we've managed to make them understand that they work together with robots in order to finish their tasks. This process repeated itself over 200,000 times, decreasing its time to validate, approve, and pay a file in less than 50 times than it would take to do it manually. Before, the entire process for one employee to be validated and approved would take maybe about 30 minutes to an hour. Now, if everybody was working on the system, it only took a few minutes. It's worth mentioning also that the Webcon BPM instant change technology helped us a lot to develop the software while it was in production. It's the same thing like building a plane while it's flying. While we at the beginning, in the first, let's say, days of working on the project, we have managed to build in the BPM only the first two or three steps of the process. But that was enough for the robots to start putting data inside the BPM. While the robot was collecting data, we worked on building the rest of the process. And as soon as the next step was finished in the process, we would let the data flow through it. And this is what I meant by instant change technology. It's a very interesting thing that probably it's worth to have its own webinar at some point. Now, the second study case we had is about a place where humans and robots work together on the same platform and collaborate in harmony in an e-commerce company. In this case, a robot has managed to replace two employees' tedious and repetitive work while enabling them to do more intelligent and essential tasks. Furthermore, the fact that the robots were doing their tasks and collaborating with the other employees on the BPM platform sped up the delivery of products. Before the BPM and the RPA robots were implemented, they were receiving orders from online and sending them to the courier the next day. Now with this platform, they are sending it in the same day, and that it's simply because everything is much more faster and controlled. Now, in this e-commerce company, the process starts in multiple online shops, from where a robot is centralizing the orders in the BPM software. At the same time, the orders are also synchronized with the accounting and the warehouse management system platforms because they already had two more softwares to work with. Now, the robot would add all the data in all those systems in a few minutes. And in all that meantime, the warehouse workers and the operation employees would keep track of the orders, and they would simply focus on handling exceptions in the BPM platform. They won't actually focus now on copy-pasting data from one platform to another. They would simply focus on how the workflow is going and handling exceptions that the robots could not deal with. In the same process, the operation employees would actually pass the tedious task of billing and creating all the delivery documents to their fast and precise coworkers, the robot. This helped the management to put the workflow on autopilot. It's an interesting way on how humans and robots, again, work together, but they work together in the same platform. Also here, another good example of what you can do with a BPM platform is to, let's say, replace the interaction of your employees with all the other systems. In this case, the employees had two other systems to work with. Now they only have one, the BPM. They put all the data in the BPM, they make sure they send the data through the process accordingly, and the robot behind makes sure that those platforms are up to date. That happened with a robot because those platforms were quite old, and especially the accounting ones. We all know how accounting software can be sometimes. Now, Cătălin would show you a demo of two of our kinds of robots working together with human employees on the same process. Cătălin?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Azel.
Take the floor immediately. Okay. Yes, for 10 minutes, I hope I won't it won't be longer. I will tell you about cute POC, I would say, a case from an HR process that we built it, that involves two type of robots, conversational robots, I mean chatbots, and RPA robots orchestrated by the BPM, in this case, Webcon BPS. Okay. Before automation, we are talking about a factory with a lot of workers, and the HR admin person should do a lot of activities, uncomfortable activities, instead of talking with the employees. We're doing a lot of stuff like generating documents like contract, responsibility sheet, GDPR agreement, registering data in some applications, registering data in the corporate application because the company is part of a group, registering data in the governmental application from Romania, that, by the way, doesn't have an API, and some other small tasks like updating an Excel sheet, sending some emails to the accountancy, to the manager, to the team leader, to prepare the equipments for the first day of the new employee. And all of these activities were taken something like 45 minutes for each employee. And now I will present you a case, a small demo, where we succeeded to do all of these things in 3 minutes. And this involved at the beginning a chatbot where the HR admin is talking about the new employee. The chatbot is communicating with the BPM, with Webcon BPS, for creating the employee record in the database. And after an workflow that maybe requires some processes of some steps of approvals, the platform will trigger a RPA robot that will fill data in the government application from Romania, Revisal, that doesn't have an API. And after doing all of those tasks, we'll report back in the system, look, everything I was instructed to do, and I will move the workflow in the next step, which is having the contract active. Okay, let's go to the real case. Here we are in Teams because the chatbot was deployed in Teams, and Christina is the HR assistant for our HR human person that will help her to accelerate the whole process. So we will naturally talk with Christina.
Alan, we only see your PowerPoint at the moment.
Oh, okay, sorry. Thank you for that.
Okay. Okay, we see Christina now.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I'll go back a little bit. We are talking with Christina in Teams. So we had hello because we are logging. She will know who the person is, and I can choose from the menu some things to do. I have a lot of options, but I can also talk with it. So I will say, look, I will have a new colleague, and can you help me? And she will say, okay, but please upload the ID card. Now we are uploading the ID card, a picture with the new employee that is not very well done. So as you can see, it is on the border of a table. So it's like a natural process, how it happens in real activities. Now I was asked when will their activity start. I can say some dates, but I can also say tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, and the chatbot will understand. I can choose after that the department which were dynamically taken from the third-party solution. So it is a list consumed by an API. I will choose HR, and you can see that the chatbot is guiding me through the process. So maybe I don't know, it's not required to know the process. Now the chatbot transferred me in the employee page in Webcon BPS, where all the data from the conversation were transferred. And I have some other information that I can complete. I can modify some things if I want. I can see also that the picture with ID card, it is there. I pressed registered. Now the process moves to the next step where Webcon BPS generated a bunch of documents based on some templates that was previously set up. Here is the employment contract. We can see that we have the variables already filled in. Sorry for being anonymized, but we couldn't share the real information. But as you can see, it was the salary and all the information is already filled. The document can also be digitally signed. Here was just a picture with the stamp and the signature. So after checking them a little bit, I can say activate. And when I will press activate, as a human, the platform will trigger the RPA robot that will receive the task with all the details from the Webcon BPS and will do all of those activities that I was telling about, filling data in different systems and sending emails and so on and so forth. So now when I will press activate, I can see that we are in a virtual machine, in a computer, let's say, where the robot is hosted. And he is waiting every moment to receive some task from the BPM, which is its supervisor. And now the robot is opening the application. Here is Beatrix, the corporate platform that is emulating the HR system. Revisar, which is the Romanian governmental application for managing employment records. And we can see now the robot, how is managing, filling the data, working with selectors. Selectors is working a little bit slower because the application is working slower because, as I was saying, robot is depending on the interface of the application. You can see how fast it's typing things. And finished with Revisal, and now he's he begins to work with the second application and filling all of the forms with all the data that he was instructed. Behind the scenes, he already filled some Excel files and sent some emails. But I will move back to the process. So now the robot moved the contract in the stage active, and the contract is registered in the database, and the workflow were finished. I want to talk a little bit, I hope not more than 1 minute, about what are the technologies involved here, what we saw. I don't intend to be very technical, but we should understand a little bit how we can make an orchestration with all of these technologies. We saw that we were beginning the conversation from Teams. The chatbot was deployed in Teams. The chatbot is not a simple chatbot, it's a Druid chatbot that can understand natural language, so has AI processes behind. We can talk with it, we can answer to the guided conversation. And chatbot is collecting all the information from the human side, and after that is transferring the data in Webcon BPS in the platform of the employee that is playing the role of an HR application. And now we can have some steps of approvals. Now in the POC, we just seen that the HR admin was checking the data, but we can build a more complicated process of approvals. And after that, the BPM should transfer information in some third-party application, which is very often the case. Can be a CRM, can be an ERP, but in this case, it's an HR system. It was, in fact, the governmental application, Revisal. And if we have the option of communicating through APIs, machine to machine, it is a good option. But if we don't have it, as it was this case, the BPM triggered the RPA robot, a UiPath robot, and the robot do all the task in the third-party application. And after that, come back in the BPM and said, look, I finished, and now I can move the workflow to the next step. And humans can see in reports that records are finished, are in some stages. In general, it is a good example of hyper automating a process, because we can have the BPM acting as a brain for the entire automation, orchestrating all the other automation technologies. But as humans, we believe that in even now and in near future, even more, we want to talk with our application. So I just want to chat with my applications. So through with the help of the chatbot, I only I'm typing some messages, and the chatbot will talk with the BPM. Chatbot will talk, and BPM will talk with the other application if it's needed. And together, we've built an orchestration where we put humans in the right place, and we put also two type of robots that are talking one with each other through the orchestration of the BPM platform, in this case, Webcon BPS. Okay, that's all for now. Let's go to the next phase of the webinar. So back to the studio. Razvan, I think you have the floor.
Yes. Now we will try and talk about some key takeaways and have a Q&A session and answer to all your questions, because we've seen some very interesting questions. But the key takeaways to take from this presentation is that RPA is used especially for automating individual tasks and repetitive ones. As long as a task can be converted into a specific set of rules, it can be automated with RPA. On the other side, BPM has an interconnected approach to optimize and automate business processes, keeping the human in the loop. BPM solutions can also serve as the safety net of, in order to handle exceptions. Whatever platform or solution you're deciding to use, both of them should definitely use low code, because this helps keeping business people in the loop. It helps with fast delivery and especially with easy maintenance. In conclusion, RPA is not an alternative for a BPM, but together they can offer a complete circle of automation. And now, I think I should go to the Q&A session first, because one of the first questions we actually had, I'm not sure if it was the first one or one of the first ones, is can you explain the difference between RPA and BPM? Well, RPA is a software that clicks through interfaces. In a nutshell, that's what it is. It clicks through interfaces and it can read data or write data exactly like a human can on a computer. So imagine a robot in front of your keyboard typing things. This is the same thing, but it's not really physical. It's just a software robot installed on your PC. The BPM on the other side is actually a platform. It has an interface. It can be web, mobile, or an application in which humans enter data and do their actual job. They attend to their processes inside that platform. Now, once the robots appeared, we have seen it as an opportunity to make them work together on the same platform. Another question kind of similar to this, I hope that that answered the first question, but another one quite similar was, what is the difference between using unattended RPA and a combination of BPM and RPA?
Very good question, I think.
Yeah, this is a very good question. Now, for people that don't really know, RPA can be attended or unattended. Attended RPA means that you have a robot installed on your PC, on your laptop. You open that robot. That robot knows how to do a task, and you are clicking start. And that robot, in the moment you've told him to do that, is going to start doing things. Unattended usually means the vendor that is selling you the RPA solution has a so-called orchestrator behind. It can be cloud or an application. It depends on the vendor. Now, they have an orchestrator that can start robots on different occasions, let's say. Either on schedule, either they can have some queues in which you can put some data and they keep doing the repetitive tasks until the queues are empty. Now, the big question is, because not always you can put a timer on a robot or you can know when is the time to add something to a queue. The best place to, let's say, trigger a robot is from inside the process. And where do you have the process? In the BPM platform. When the process reached a certain step in the BPM platform, you simply trigger from the BPM platform the robot and or add something to the queue of the robot, and the robot would take care of it. So unattended is not enough if you don't know when or how to actually start your robots. If you have the process in a digital manner and at some point when your process reaches a certain step, you can trigger that robot, that is great. A BPM can do that very well, and most of them have already off-the-shelf robot, let's say, triggering from their low code designers.
Most of, and more than that, Razvan, I would say that you want to have the statistics of the process in the same place. Either you are using humans for the processes or robots. You want to have to be aware of the entire process of and of the bottlenecks in the same place. Because if you have humans in a BPM and robots reporting in the orchestrator, and then after that you are trying to merge reports to understand how things are going in your organizations, it's more difficult. But if you have everything based on the steps of the process in the same place, even if you are using humans or robots, is a better approach. And if the robot will encounter some errors, you want to give that feedback exactly on the step that you are, and not at the end of the process, because sometimes at the end of the process is too late to make analysis and to see what to improve. But you want a solution in the very moment. And if for real the robot is stuck, you want the task to be rooted to a human person, and after that to process to continue naturally. And this orchestration is not only about rising robots, which the orchestrator is basically do, it's more than that. It's supervising robots and integrating them in the process.
Yes, it's important that not only humans can give work to robots, but also robots can give back work to humans.
Yes, correctly. Yes, we didn't underline that.
Now we have two more questions, a bit more complex ones. One is related to guidance towards the RPA pricing. And another one, if it's if we are approaching, if I'm understanding well, it's quite a long question. The question is that that you are asking is if we are approaching our customers from a closed loop business process management point of view, and if we try and.
Actually, Razvan, let me interrupt, yes, because I want to read this question, because actually it refers largely, maybe not intently, to my section of this webinar.
Great.
And for the audience to see what we're talking about. Well. Let's see. I mean, I'll read it from my end. So there's a statement first with premises. So we see significant developments in the direction of automated process improvement, parenthesis, robotic process mining or automated process improvement, predictive process monitoring and prescriptive process monitoring, actionable process mining or causal process mining, modeling PM or what if process mining, etc. I already have to take a breath. And many adjacent solutions, parentheses, enterprise-ready process mining services, RPA-powered intelligent process automation solutions, search and AI-driven data analytics enterprises platforms and business intelligence platforms providing data management solutions. So, and this is just premises, okay? So we haven't gotten even to the question. One of these next levels of process optimization is closed loop business process management, parenthesis CLBPM, where execution management systems can help companies in difficult tasks to move from the initial setup to continuous and structured process monitoring and improvement. Question, are you open in this type of BPM applications? So this was asked by Danielle. Danielle, I talked about a spaghetti of acronyms and abundance of acronyms and terms and phrases. To a certain extent, I'm not sure how serious this question is, whether it's a bit of a trolling in terms of like tongue-in-cheek concept to showcase how many other acronyms we haven't even touched. But my answer, my personal answer would be, let's talk about specific use cases, because if we were to untangle even the things that you mentioned on the one webinar, I think we would need like 3 hours to just describe what are we really talking about. Because if there's anybody that can quickly explain a combination of robotic process mining, automated process improvement, and predictive and prescriptive process monitoring, then you'd be really, really great. But I think it takes a while. All right, that was it from my end.
Yeah, we should definitely have a, let's say, follow-up meeting with this. We'll get in touch and try and expand more on all of this, and especially why it's important to have continuous and structured process monitoring and improvement. From my point of view, workflows and processes inside companies are alive. They keep developing, they keep moving around, and the systems cannot stay behind. So they need to move and continuously be developed, which BPMs, especially low-code BPMs, can deal with.
I would add that we shouldn't be fanatic that you should use only RPA or only BPM. Of course, there are cases when if you need just automating, taking some data from an Excel file and consolidating a report and send an email, okay, an attended robot is just fine for you, and that's all. But that's why it's valuable, the consultancy services, to see exactly what you want to achieve. all the technologies has their pros and cons, but we should think in the business way, not about technology. This is, by the way, our and Corsa's mission. Let's not put technology above the business goals. We are talking about business. We are talking about achieving some things, and our technology is only to serve us achieving those goals. And we are trying to clarify a little bit. But as Michael said, if we will explain what is predictive analytics and the AI plus RPA plus process mining, I think we won't succeed to clarify it too much, because if we are looking at the questions are quite normal. People, what is RPA? What is BPM? How should I use a robot? Or the first question that we've missed, how would you guide clients to consider pricing of RPA? See, it's a simple question. I want to benefit of this technology, but I'm a little bit somehow confused. How should I use it? Is it okay to begin with an attended robot, with an unattended robot? What is the case? So we should stick to simplification, because otherwise we just make more confusion in the whole thing. So answer to this question, going about prices and what's the best strategy, it's depending on your needs. You can, as I said, you can use an attended robot or in conjunction with the BPM, or you can use an attended robot, or you can use some other RPA technologies, because now there are many providers in the market, and there are different way of pricing per transactions, per robot. So there are different way of pricing these technologies, but we need that at the beginning to understand specifically your needs.
I think to a certain extent, and full disclaimer, I'm not RPA expert, but I believe it's also a question of how do you justify certain price, right? Because there are certain things that we can quantify. So if you can count, for example, what is the FTE, like full-time equivalent of things that you can save by introducing certain technology, not necessarily just RPA, but also BPM and also many other ones, that's a one way to go. Or like how much faster your processes will be handled. Therefore, like how much more things your employees will be able to do instead of doing some manual tasks.
Budget reduction.
Exactly. So there are, let's say, quantifiable benefits and also things that you cannot quantify, like quality of work. Like I don't have to type everything manually. So I'm much happier because of that. And I can focus on more strategic tasks that I have on my table. And I believe you should always look at the combination of both and then try to evaluate them versus the price and versus the capabilities and features and things that you can do with a certain piece of software.
Also,
how much does it cost? One second. How much does it cost if our competition has digital services and I don't have it, and maybe I will lose clients? It's not easy to quantify how much business I'm losing if I'm not improving things right now.
Exactly. One of the things that especially the pandemic times showed us is how important customer service is if you cannot have like human interaction. So this is invaluable.
Also, maybe pricing related a little bit is that both RPA and BPM give you value, the most value, when you actually implement as many processes as you can with them. If you get a robot, you would have that robot 24 hours a day. That would cost you some money. And if you don't use all the time the robot can work in, you are losing money. So you don't get the most out of the robot. So the more processes you automate with a robot, your robot, the more work it can do with the same price, let's say money. The same goes for the BPM. You should take in consideration digitalizing all your processes, most of the processes inside your company, if not all of them, one by one, but don't get it only for one single small process. No, get it for a core process. And then after you've finished with your core process, start digitalizing all those other small processes that consume, that are consuming your energy.
Great. Well, I see Danielle from the previous question, the long one, went into interaction with us on a couple of occasions. So let's stay in touch. You can touch base with
I am already Catalina. In touch with Danielle before the webinar. So
okay. So we are good. All right.
Great.
Okay.
Okay, thank you guys for the presentation, and thank you all for staying till the end of the webinar. After the webinar ends, so you can please you will have a short survey that we ask you to fill, that it will help us to improve our future webinars. If you want to stay in touch, you can follow us on LinkedIn and on our website. And if you have any other questions, you can write us an email, and we'll answer that one. Also, for all of you that stay till the end and participating on this webinar, if you want to, we can book a 2-hour free consultancy relating to on your specific needs, business needs. So thank you all, and see you on the next webinar.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Have a great day.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Daniel.